This morning, barking to the choir with Father Greg Boyle. Father Greg Boyle, best known as Father Greg by all who meet him, has been an advocate for at-risk and gang-involved youth in Los Angeles and around the world for 25 years. Born in Los Angeles as one of 8 siblings, Father Greg entered the Order of the Society of Jesus, the Jesuits, and was ordained a priest in 1984. He is the founder and director of Jobs for a Future, Homeboy Industries, the largest gang intervention and employment referral program for gang-involved youth in the United States. Father Greg is an acknowledged expert on gangs and intervention approaches and is a nationally renowned speaker. He is a consultant to youth service and governmental agencies, policymakers and employers, and serves as a member of the National Gang Center Advisory Board with the United States Department of Justice. And he's on the advisory board for the Lola Law School Center for Juvenile Law and Policy in Los Angeles. I invite you to enjoy Barking to the Choir, Father Greg Boyle.
Thank you all very much. Never been in the arena before. I'm a little undone by these screens. I had no idea that I was bald. Thank you for pointing that out to me. You know, it's so great to come here and to be surrounded by so many great friends. Thank you for your attendance this morning, for your attention. The attention is what folks are always looking for. I remember not long ago at Homeboy Industries, a 16-year-old gang member, very earnest, came and stood in front of me, in front of my desk, and he said, "Look, I need your divided attention." I said, "You are in luck." So you're probably wondering, what the hell is this title all about, Barking to the Choir? And somebody said, are you going to write another book? And I don't recommend this at home. I begin with the title and I work backwards, which is a really dumb way to write a book. So I arrived on this title. The full title is Barking to the Choir, Now Entering the Kinship of God. So, and it comes, as everything in my life, comes from a story of a homie who also was in my office. And I thought we were having something of a transformational conversation, and I was running it down to him, giving him glecha, as we say in the barrio, about some particular detour his life had taken. And he stops me at some point in midpoint, and he says, "Look, you're barking to the choir." And I loved it. I thought, you know, because it was, as homies often do, it's a combo burger of, obviously, barking up the wrong tree and preaching to the choir. And I liked it. It spoke to me. So I will write a book with that title and try to find words to fill the pages. In order to enter the kinship of God, we need to bark up the wrong tree and preach to the choir so that God's dream will come true, that you may be one kinship. Thomas Wolfe in You Can't Go Home Again writes, "To lose the earth you know for greater knowing, to lose the life you have for greater life, to leave the friends you loved for greater loving, to find a land more kind than home, more large than earth." The kinship of God won't come unless we shake things up. To lose the earth, you know. To bark up the wrong tree, propose something new. Bertrand Russell once said that every great idea starts out as blasphemy. How do we become then, with Jesus, a sign of contradiction in our world, in our cities? A theme pervasive throughout the biblical narrative is that God enters our midst to upset the status quo, precisely to bark up the wrong tree. The Magnificat in Luke's gospel, where the powerful are brought low and the hungry are filled with good things, was seen as so subversive in Guatemala that the government at one time banned its public recitation. How do we retrieve that kind of a speaking truth to power? But the truth is, my own tiny-spirited, puny self accommodates all the time to the status quo. We do this all the time. We adapt, we conform, we reconfigure everything so that the status quo feels welcome and at home. I remember years ago, 27 years ago, when I was in Bolivia, I got this bug, this bichu, they would call it, and it wanted to live in peace in your body. You know, it didn't want to upset the apple cart. It didn't want to have you spending days, in the bathroom. It wanted to coexist with you and not upset the status quo. So I had no symptoms except that I had lost 60 pounds. I'm thinking of going back. But the status quo doesn't want things to get upset. The status quo is division, polarity, the striking of the high moral distance. How do we awaken from the dream of separateness, from the status quo that lulls us into blindly accepting the things that divide and keep us from our own holy longing for mutuality? It was a great privilege of my life to know Cesar Chavez as a friend, and I remember once a reporter had commented to him, "Wow, these farm workers, they sure love you." And Cesar shrugged and he smiled and he said, "The feeling's mutual." And that's what we hope for. And so we ask questions, as Wendell Berry writes, that go beyond the available answers. To lose the life you have for greater life, we seek to bridge the distance even in our service of others. I am the service provider. That gang member over there is the service recipient. But the truth is, at Homeboy Industries, I am not the healer, and that gang member is in need of my exquisite healing. We all need healing. It's mutual. Emil Mersch writes, "We are all a cry for help." There was a homie named Caesar. Everybody called him Dreamer. And he was a kid that grew up in the housing projects, Pico Gardens, when I was pastor of Dolores Mission. And I knew him as a little mococito and growing up, and he got into a gang. And nobody got more jobs through Homeboy Industries than this guy, Caesar. And but he would either work in the private sector where we located him employment or in one of our many businesses at Homeboy Industries. But before too long, in those days anyway, he's now gotten his life quite together. But in those days, he'd always sort of gravitate back to vague criminality, usually something involving drugs, the sale of or the use of. And, you know, ours is a God who waits, and who are we not to? So this one time he had finished a four-month stretch in county jail, a violation of his probation, And then he appeared in my office, as he would. And he was about 25 years old at the time, a very intelligent kid, hugely funny, dangerous sense of humor. And so he's sitting there, and he says what homies often say, "This time it'll be different." And I go, you know. So I pick up the phone, and with him there, I call a friend of mine who runs a vending machine company in Alhambra, California. And right away, he hires, on the spot, our friend Caesar. Well, 2 weeks later, Caesar's in my office. He's just gotten his first paycheck at the vending machine company. And he's sitting in front of me in my office, and he's proudly waving his very first paycheck. "Damn, G, this paycheck makes me feel proper." I mean, my jefita, she's proud of me. And my morritos, they're not ashamed of me. And you know who I have to thank for this job. And I said, "Well, who?" And he looked at me strangely and he said, "Well, God, of course." "Oh, sure." No, that's right. That's right, God. And he said, "You thought I was going to say you, didn't you?" "No. Gosh, no, absolutely God's number one." He said, "You are so lucky we're not living in them Genesis days." I'm sorry, them Genesis days? And he said, "Yeah, because God would have been had struck down your ass already by now." Now, I ask you, really, who exactly is the service provider there, and who's the service recipient? We just dissolved in laughter. Mutuality, now entering kinship, which is to say we are called to luxuriate in this mutuality. An odd thing, you know, for 25 years I've been working with gang members, an odd thing that's happened in the last, I want to say 3 years, I don't know how to explain it, but homies and homegirls ask me for blessings all the time. And usually on Fridays, you know, it's kind of, it's a blessing before the weekend comes, and certainly before Christmas break or a long weekend. And they can ask me anywhere, you know, out in front of our headquarters in Chinatown or in the reception area or in my office. And they never say, "Father, may I have your blessing?" They always say it exactly the same way, and it never varies. "Hey, G, give me a bless, yeah?" Always, they always say it the same way. And so I'm in my office on a Friday towards the end of the day, and I'm talking to this kid, Chris. And Chris works for me, though work may be too strong a verb here. And Chris just turned 18, and he's kind of one of the orphan kids we have, you know, a kid who was thoroughly, completely, resoundingly abandoned by his parents and had to sort of raise himself, which kids are not supposed to be very good at. And so he works for me, and we helped him get his own little apartment. And anyway, he's sitting there, and he's kind of exasperating. I'll be honest with you. He's a complaining, whining. He's always whining. He's always being pediche. He's always asking me for feria, you know, and I can't pay this. And he's hard to take sometimes, I'll be honest with you. So he finishes his whining fest, it's Friday, so he says, "Hey, G, give me a bless, yeah." I said, "Sure." So he knows the drill, and he comes around to my side of the desk, and he very devoutly bows his head and closes his eyes, and I put my hands on his shoulder, and, well, his birthday was just 2 days before, so this gives me an opportunity to say some things to him. "Chris, I'm glad you were born. I feel like I'm a rich man that you're in my life. I'm proud to call you son." And then I don't know why I added this last part. I said, "Even though at times you can be a huge pain in the ass." And he looks up and he smiles at me and he says, "The feeling's mutual." And Joseph Campbell writes, if you want to change the world, change the metaphor. Kinship is the game changer. It is the pearl of great price. It is the treasure buried in the field. Let's go and sell everything to get it. Yet we think kinship is always beyond our reach, más allá de esta vida. I was reading the New York Times the other day, and I noticed there's a play that's opening. I don't know anything about the play, but the title leapt out at me, and the title is this, Now Hear This. But it's not like the announcement that you would have over a loudspeaker, Now Hear This. It's written this way, now, period. Here, as in here in this place, period. This, period. This kinship, here and now. Gospel kinship always exposes the game. It jostles the status quo, always in need of conversion, because the status quo incessantly judges and compares and measures and competes. And we, the choir, were stuck in complacency. I need this conversion. The church needs this conversion. And if the people of God would lead, who doubts that the bishops would follow? It's how conversion works. The most gracious moments that happened for me when I was the pastor of the poorest parish in the city of Los Angeles, Dolores Mission, was when the people of God there, monolingual, largely uneducated, at least not formally, when the people of God would lead, and occasionally I'd have a momentary lapse of humility, and I'd follow. To lose the earth, you know, for greater knowing, now, here, this, we bark to the choir so that we can move from the isolation of judgment to the kinship of awe. In the Acts of the Apostles, they seem to measure the health of the Christian community in a variety of ways. See how they love each other, etc. But one of the ways in which they measured the health of the community was in this way. It writes, and awe came upon everyone. This past year sometime I was invited to speak, give a training, an all-day training to 600 social workers in Richmond, Virginia. I brought two homies with me, Andre, who's at our booth working today, and Jose, both of them in their late 20s. And so it was an all-day training, just the three of us, so I spoke for most of it, but every once in a while I'd get them up to help run the thing and tell their stories. I had heard pieces of their story. I remember I knew some of the main markers of Jose's life, that at 8 years old, Jose started to drink and sniff glue. At nine, picked up his first case, an assault. At 12, he was jumped into his gang. I know that he had spent 2.5 years locked up as a young man for having stabbed his mother's boyfriend who was attempting to abuse him sexually. I knew those markers, but I hadn't heard the whole story told by him. So he gets up to tell his story, and he's kind of in an offhanded way. He says, yeah, I guess you could say my mom and I, we didn't get along so good. I think I was 6 when she looked at me and she said, why don't you just kill yourself? You're such a burden to me. And the whole audience gasped. And then he said, it sounds way worser in Spanish. And everybody laughed. He said, I guess I was 9 when my mom drove me down to the deepest part of Baja California, and she walks me into an orphanage, and she says, I found this kid. And there she left me for 90 days until my grandmother could find out where she had dumped me, and she came and rescued me. My mom beat me every single day of all my elementary school years with things you could imagine and some things you couldn't. I used to wear 3 t-shirts every day. First t-shirt because the blood would seep through, and the second t-shirt because you could still see it. Finally, the third t-shirt, you couldn't see the blood. Kids at school would make fun of me. Hey, fool, it's 100 degrees. Why are you wearing 3 t-shirts? And then he kind of buckles and chokes up and gets emotional in front of these social workers, and he says, I wore 3 t-shirts well into my adult years because I didn't want to see my wounds. But then I started to welcome my wounds. And now I run my fingers over my wounds. They are my friends. After all, I can't help heal the wounded if I haven't welcomed my own wounds. And awe came upon everyone. From the book of Daniel, we hear, deliver us by your wonders. Well, not just miracles, but the sheer size of what some people have to carry. How can we find this mutuality of kinship that can stand in awe at what the poor have to carry rather than stand in judgment at how they carry it? There is a Mayan saying, you are the other me, and I am the other you. God created an otherness so that we'd find our way to kinship. God created margins so that we'd dedicate ourselves to their erasure, to the birth of a new inclusion. In the Quran, it says, I create diverse tribes so that you might come to know each other. A land more kind than home, more large than earth. There's a homie in my office named Saul. He's also one of our orphans. He's 19 years old now. But he came home from school one day at 9 to discover that his mom had packed her bags, walked out of his life, and he never saw her again. He was alone in the world, no sibs, no relatives, absolutely alone. He spent lots of years as a homeless kid, for as remarkable as that seems for as young as he was, until he got into the system, and the system didn't treat him so well. And then we met him at Homeboy probably when he was 16. He was on the run, and then he was in and out of probation camps and stuff. And now he seems to have settled somewhat. Has his own apartment that we've helped him get. Lives by himself. Shows up every day. He's just about to graduate from our school. You know, he's one of those kids that psychologists would describe as having a disorganized attachment. You know, when mom is frightening or frightened, you don't know how to calm yourself down if you've never been soothed. Saul's one of those kids. So he kind of has meltdowns only all the time and has moments of rage. And he emotionally deregulates on a regular basis. Anyway, he came in one morning before the day began, and he said, hey, gee, I got to tell you about what happened last night. And he says that, you know, he says, I went to King Taco to get something to eat. It was kind of late and it was a little cold and I'm trying to rush home. And I walked past that park, you know the one over near King Taco. And as I walked past the park, I see an old man. He's lying on a bench and he's asleep, but he's shivering because it's kind of cold. I see an old empty bottle, 40-ouncer bottle on the floor underneath the bench. I walk up to him and I look at him. And you know that sweater that I like a lot, I wear all the time, I took it off and I put it over the man on the bench. And he didn't wake and didn't know I did it. And I'm not telling you this because I want you to think I'm all that. I told you this because I know that bench. I've been on that bench. And Saul connects in the way God hopes we will. Saul and Jose of the three t-shirts come to know their own light because they are willing to walk through their own darkness. Richard Rohr tells us that we are programmed and wired for union. So when we feel separated from the rest, we are on the wrong track and living in what Albert Einstein called a kind of optical delusion, a prison, he says. And our task is to free ourselves from this prison. Tax collectors and prostitutes, Jesus says, are entering the kingdom before you. Can we all agree that Jesus is not talking about heaven? And the tax collector and prostitute represent the judged, the scapegoated, the less than. I was horrified once to hear a story that a homie who worked for me years ago, he must have been 30, and he was telling me this story sort of in an offhanded way. He said that his mom and his father were having this verbal argument, quite ferocious, and he was a tiny little kid watching this. And in one moment, the father just punches the mother so forcefully that she just falls to the ground with a thud, cold cocks her, and she's lying on the floor unconscious. And the father hasn't broken a sweat and very calmly turns to his son and he says, "Now that's how you hit a woman." And in our horror at that story, we are repelled. We move quickly away in judgment at the father, who almost certainly was mentally ill or had been deeply exposed to such violence as a kid. And we move from the son, whose eventual gang activity later was surely shaped by such a moment. But how do we move from blame to understanding, which is a hallmark of the kinship of God? Entering the kinship of God requires humility. Humility asks of those on the margins, "What do you need? How can I help you?" But hubris says, "Here's what your problem is. Here's how you fix it." I mean, don't you people know the difference between right and wrong? Humility ushers in the kinship of God, and hubris impedes our entrance into kinship. I've been so blessed in the last quarter of a century. The homies have always been experts at humbling me. I owe them so much. I remember once we were having a conversation in my office and one kid just out of the blue, "Hey, G, can I ask you a question?" I said, "Sure. Are you Russian?" I said, no, why? Well, it's just your hairline. It'd be Russian all the way back there. Thank you very much. You know, Homeboy has changed so much over 25 years. You know, I don't really run the place anymore like I did in the early days. You know, the homies have taken ownership of the place, which is good because that's the way it should be. You know, and 15,000 folks show up from all over the county, and a free tattoo removal, 3 laser machines, 29 volunteer doctors, 800 treatments a month. We have a school, huge numbers of case managers and mental health team. Every imaginable curricular thing from anger management to grief and loss to parenting, you name it, we do it. We help a legal team, all our businesses from Homeboy Diner in the City Hall to we're about to be in the extension at the new LAX American Terminal and Homegirl Cafe and Silkscreen and Bakery. And thank you for buying chips and salsas in the stores. Leave no salsa behind. So that's huge now. You know, we have 300 trainees, and I mean, it's just thousands of homies have worked there and gone through there and get help there. So I don't run it like I did in the early days. In the early days, all the homies that know me from the olden days know that, you know, I had sort of a magic wand. You know, you need this, I'll handle it. Okay, you start tomorrow, that kind of thing. So homies will come to me, and they always try to retrieve the magic wand days. Come on, G, just hire me. I could start tomorrow. I know you could let me do it. And I go, no. You know, we have a process. So show up on Friday at 11 to drug test. And if you're clean, they'll give you a date. You show up for that date for the orientation meeting. If you've hit that marker and shown up, then they'll give you a date for the selection committee. That's 3 people. I'm not on it. And they decide whether you work here. And that's the way it should be. But he wasn't having it. Oh, come on, G, I know you can. Okay, look. None of us, this is probably manipulative. I don't know why I went there, but I did it. You know, I'll admit it. And I said, look, none of us are going to get out of this alive. I mean, I'll be honest with you. I have leukemia. I'm not going to be here forever. And there was this pause, and he looked at me, and he said, hire me before you go. That just took my breath away. 12-step programs say that without humility and honesty, nothing new happens. And barking to the choir hopes to create something new. Jesus says how hard it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. It is not a story about heaven, and it's not a story about bank accounts. It's about humility versus hubris. It's about a refusal to allow the poor and those on the margins to have a purchase on us, to bring us into the grace of mutuality. Dives, after all, was not in hell because he was rich, but because he failed to recognize his essential kinship with Lazarus. And so it turns out that the illusion of separateness is hell. I remember years ago, 20 years ago probably, I was walking in the projects, Pico Gardens, late at night, a summer night. And it must have been late because there weren't that many folks out. And then I saw this homie, Victor, all by himself, 17-year-old gang member, sitting on the stoop in front of his apartment in Pico Gardens. So I walk him, hey, Victorine, ¿qué onda? And I sit down next to him. And he said, hey, gee, it's amazing that you would show up right now. I said, why? Well, I was just sitting here praying. I said, really? Yeah, and I said, God, give me a sign that you are as great as I think you are. And then you showed up. And I find myself welcomed into this humble presence where mutuality is offered and separateness is obliterated. And I think to myself, the day won't ever come when I am as gracious and noble as this 17-year-old gang member sitting on the stoop of his apartment in the projects. I gave up a long time ago trying to be as holy as the people I've been privileged to serve. There's a homie who works for me named Robert, about 30, had a share of trouble in prison a lot and in the Shoe and Pelican Bay, and now he's a navigator. He kind of helps the little guys navigate their lives at Homeboy. Well, you know, he's on parole, high control parole, so there's a lot of vigilance around his life, I guess. And his parole officer raided the house in which he was living, and he was living with this family. And in the house was a young boy who had a toy gun. And the parole officer violated Robert, who was employed and doing exceedingly well, and gave him 90 days in jail for this toy gun that happened to be in the house where this parolee lived, and all of us paid for those 90 days. And when he got out, of course, I, you know, brought him right back to work. But I called him in my office. I said, when I heard why they violated you, I thought, gosh, what Robert must be thinking. I don't know. Such an injustice and stupidity would have taken me to that place, I suppose, where anger takes over, I guess. He looked at me with great gentle warmth, and he smiled, and he said, if you're humble, you'll never stumble. Pretty great. We need then to embrace the journey towards humility rather than our struggle for perfection. None of us gets very much right most of the time. I knew a young homies named Cartoon and Little Whisper. These are common gang black gossels. Little Whisper, he's named after an older homie who's named Whisper. And they were young guys. This was years ago. And of course, they have a spray can and an empty wall, so you do the math. So Cartoon is writing on the wall, and Little Whisper is lookout. And Cartoon is, going as fast as he can, and a little bit paniqueado, because what if the jura shows up, and et cetera. And so he finishes, and they stand back to admire their handiwork. And Cartoon has written, Carton, C-A-R-T-O-N, which means cardboard in Spanish. And instead of Little Whisper, he has written, Lil Wiper. Now, I encourage them that maybe they should return to school. But all of us are missing a letter. Might as well get used to it. God is like an extremely skilled chef. He wastes nothing. Not lemon rinds, not bread crusts, not pan drippings, not sin, failure, or limitation. I remember last year I was speaking in a church in Escondido, packed church, to the rafters, choir loft, standing room only, and the woman who was introducing me, before she introduced me, she was something of a civic leader, and she was trying to kind of galvanize the troops. So many people showed up. What if we turned the presence of all these people here into something positive in our community? All hands on deck. It was a good message before she introduced me, and she was getting to the end, and she had notes, but she, you know, was flying without the benefit of a net. And she didn't consult her notes because she was on a roll. And then she was about to finish, and she said, and as Father Greg Boyle says so eloquently in his book, Tattoos on the Heart, God does not love you. And the whole audience went, "Hi, God." And I'm sitting there going, "Whoa." And she goes, "Oh, well, wait a minute, that doesn't sound right. No, here it is. Not only does God love you, It's God's joy to love you. Well, that's really completely different. Well, the whole place just roared with laughter. And yeah, she was red in the face, but and embarrassed. But you could see that the whole place, I don't even know how to describe it. It was just transformational, where everybody sort of held her, and it was just this wonderful time of kinship, and a humiliating moment is transformed into humble grace. A homie who works for me gave me this insight once about God. He says, you know, God is that person pushing the shopping cart and going through your garbage. But sometimes we don't want him to go through our garbage. And he says, I want your garbage. But that's because God recycles. He recycles our garbage. And he turns it into love, he says. When we are disappointed in each other, we least resemble God. Disappointment seems to be the one language God does not speak. We rub people's noses and stuff. God doesn't. To be convinced of my own acceptance by God, I must know that I am accepted at my worst. Hence, moral outrage is the opposite of God. It only polarizes and separates what God wants united in kinship. And besides, moral outrage never leads us to solutions. It keeps us from them. Ernest Becker writes that the root of all evil is our denial of our own creaturehood. It is what Walter Brueggemann calls the scandal of the particular. So instead, we seek perfection, and that's nonsense, because the Word became flesh. The incarnation is always about particularity and the ordinary, and boy, does that frighten us. Because we want our sacred spectacular. We want it to be a cast of thousands and a cost of millions and gold-plated with fireworks. I remember at the turn of the century, I got a grant from the Durfee Foundation in 2000. And I got 3 months off. Part of the time was I went to, they demanded that you leave the country, that you couldn't be in phone call range. So I went to the Holy Land. I went with a great friend of mine, Jim Hayes, a Jesuit friend. And I get up really early. I get up at 4 a.m. And our hotel was not far from the Sea of Galilee. And I remember walking out to the sea, and it was still dark, just dimly lit by the moon. And I'm right at the water's edge. And it's so still and quiet, and I can hear the gentle lapping of the water against the shore. And I look out there and I say, wow, Jesus was here with his friends in a boat. He walked on this water. And I'm sort of getting caught up in this mystical moment when suddenly there's a flash of light behind me. And it illumines the whole area where I am. And I say, yes, Lord. And I turn around. And the McDonald's is opening right there. And so I got a cup of coffee. And there's God in the particularity of fluorescent light and an egg McMuffin. In Kings it says, not in the wind, not in the earthquake, not in the fire, but in the tiny whispering sound. God is always hidden, ready for us to discover him in the tiny thing, in the ordinary human thing. Not long ago, there were homies, again, at the end of the day in my office, and it was payday, it was Friday, and a new worker had just gotten his first paycheck, and he was so happy. And he turns to another homie. I was giving them my divided attention. I think I was texting to somebody, and I hear him say to the other homie, "Hey, you know what I'm going to do with this? I'm going to take my mom to dinner tonight." And the other homie says, "Hey, fool, go to that place, Charlie Brown's. They got cloth napkins." Or once years ago, two homies, it was the end of the day, we're locking up the office, and one homie turns to another guy, big, huge guy named Josue, big vato with tattoos, and, "Hey, dog, what are you going to do right now?" He says, "I'm going to go home and take me a bath." Then he turns to all the gathered and he says, "Calgon, take me away." It just killed me. God everywhere, found in all things, as Ignatius would say, or as the Australian Aboriginals put it, God is everywhen. Now, these things are delicate to talk about, but we're family, we're friends. I was in a diocese recently, somewhere in the country, where I was talking with a priest, and they had just gotten a mandate from the bishop that said, from this moment forward, it is prohibited to have eulogies at funerals. And the priest cannot mention the name of the deceased in the homily. I don't know. Who can figure that out? I suppose it has something to do with wanting to safeguard the sanctity of the resurrection. But that's what it looks like when we're afraid of the incarnation. Kathleen Norris writes, "The incarnation is the place where hope contends with fear." I think that's exactly right. And quite frankly, with all due respect, and excuse me for saying this, but as a church, we busy ourselves translating the liturgy from the original Latin into an English that no one in the English-speaking world speaks. Because we are afraid of the incarnation. It's fear. That was a fear-driven decision. What if the people of God forget that the Eucharist is sacred? That's the fear. So we wrestle the cup from the hands of Jesus at the Last Supper, and we replace it quickly with a chalice, gold-plated and jewel-encrusted, because who doesn't know that a chalice is more sacred than a cup? Never mind that Jesus used a cup. But Jesus is not concerned that we might forget the Eucharist is sacred. He loses sleep over the fact that we might forget that it was ordinary, a meal with friends. And to our frightened hearts, Jesus says, "Be strong. Fear not." If we want to change the world, change the metaphor. We bark to the choir and usher in the kinship of God when we find the luminous within the particular, in the English we actually speak, in the ordinary stuff of our lives, Emmanuel, God with us. This is in part what we hope for in the experiment, which is Homeboy Industries. The homies start to grow comfortable in God's tenderness. They discover who they are in that, and they let that place of particularity get fed. So at Homeboy Industries, an occasion is created for resilience, born in a trauma-informed community. Our hope is to offer homies containment. We hold them, and then you watch through love, saturated with kindness, neurons get rewired by this secure attachment. There's a homie named Louie who I saw not long ago in my office who works for me, and he's there early, like 7:30 in the morning, and he sees me, gives me a big abrazo, and he follows me into my office. I got to tell you what happened the other day. I think I'm a rehabilitated gang member. I said, do tell. Well, the other day I was sitting on a bus next to this rich guy, and I'm thinking, how many rich guys take the bus, you know, but be that as it may. And he's sitting there, and the guy has a proper-ass cell phone. Oh, gosh, it does all sorts of things. I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, my old self, with the minute the doors open, I'd grab that cell phone, and I'd be bolt right out of the bus. That's my old self. And then the guy saw that I was sort of admiring and looking at his cell phone. He hands me the cell phone. And I look at it, and I can't believe he's handed this to me. And I look at it, and I observe it, and I give it back to him, and I give him some advice. Hey, can I give you some advice? Don't hand your stuff to people. I mean, you don't know who they are. I mean, my old self would have just run off the bus with this cell phone. But now, I'm a rehabilitated gang member. Because I work at Homeboy Industries. And he said, I learned a new word today because I told that story to my therapist, Teresa. And the new word I learned was integrity. I said, really, integrity? He said, yeah, because after I told that story, Teresa looked at me and she said, Saul, you are a man of integrity. And you can feel what Martin Luther King calls the power of God transforming the fatigue of despair into the buoyancy of hope. A thrill of hope, a weary homie rejoices. Mary Oliver, the poet, writes, let everyone in the world who suffers have a day off. You help those on the margins discover their plentitude, and in the process you begin to inhabit yours as well. Everyone return to themselves, and a new inclusion is born. Homies don't have to measure up, and neither do you. You just have to show up to the truth of yourself, knowing that you are exactly what God had in mind when God made you. I used to tell a lot of stories about a kid named Pee-Pee. I mentioned him in my book, but the lawyers at Simon & Schuster forced me to change his name and just about everybody else's as if he was going to sue me. But he was a kid who grew up in our office, and a lot of famous stories about Pee-Pee. And a slow kid, special ed, and always getting into trouble. And now he's 22 years old with two sons. But he, in those days, he was just a little mococito and skinny, filthy, tiny, slow. You know, my office folks taught him how to tell time and how to, you know, what date his birthday was on. He didn't know, you know. But he kind of was like this dry sponge that got this water of attention, and it brought the sponge to life. And I remember one night I was doing the 6 o'clock vigil mass at Dolores Mission. It was hot summer and all the doors are open, the side doors are open. And I'm preaching, standing in front of the congregation, and all of a sudden Pee-Pee appears at the door, and he's out of breath and skinny and filthy and just beaming, and he's just out of breath and just, but so overjoyed. And I look at him, I go, Pee-Pee, what are you doing? And he looks at me and he says, I'm finding you. And the homies can look in the mirror and say, I'm finding you. With all the beauty and mystical fragrance of boundlessness that God intends for us all. Timothy Keller writes, we are all getting to the brink of Jesus' message, but not to the heart. Now, here, this. This is the time of fulfillment. The kinship of God is at hand, the heart of the message. Kinship is not a reward to come later, bestowed at the end. It's here and it's now. It's at hand. It's not around the corner. It is the corner. All of us are looking for a home for our hearts. This joins us inextricably together. And God hopes for this right worship in seeking kinship with each other. God is always hoping we will bypass praising him for his compassion and move quickly to being compassionate in the world. And let's face it, we've all created God in our own image. We think that God wants us to alabare ourselves into a lathered dither, but God is too busy loving us to want a return on that gift. All projection, all perception is projection. But what we really have is a God who doesn't want our praise. There's no hidden agenda. God is pure giver, singular love. I know that if I were God, I would want praise, admiration, and worship. That's my projection. How do I know that this is the last thing on God's mind? Well, because it's the first thing on mine. That you may be one. That's it. That's what God wants. I was invited to San Francisco to give a talk to about 1,000 judges in this kind of conference, and I brought two homegirls with me, Tammy and Emily. Older ladies, Tammy, African-American, Emily, Latina. Tough, you know, big girls. You know, they've been to prison and tattooed. You wouldn't want to meet them in a dark alley or even a well-lit one, you know, And Emily is the supervisor of our janitorial crew, and Tammy works one of the people at our reception area. And so they'd never been on a plane and everything. So we fly to Oakland, and we're going to rent a car. And so I'm making the transaction at the rental car with the nice lady there. And they're just off a little bit to the side, but not in line, not up with me. And they're wearing these two huge, bulky sweatshirts that say Homeboy Industries, Jobs Not Jails. You can purchase those at our booth. And and they're just standing there, and I'm wearing a shirt that has embroidered Homeboy Industries. And so the woman, nice lady, she finishes this transaction, and then she says, "Can I ask you a question?" I said, "Sure. What's Homeboy Industries?" I said, "Well, it's the largest gang intervention rehab and reentry program in the country, and these two nice ladies are going with me, and we're going to speak to 1,000 judges." "Oh, wow, how interesting. Would you like me to put them down as additional drivers?" And I look at the woman, I say, "Are you out of your mind?" And everyone in earshot just laughs, you know, And so we get the keys, and I'm walking, and I can hear Tammy. She's trailing. And as she walks past the woman, "Thanks for trying." So there are two kind of talks. One is a workshop with, you know, a couple hundred judges. And then I'm going to give the keynote at lunch. And so we go to the workshop first, and so I let them be more featured in it. I kind of say a little something. I introduce Tammy and Emily, and they tell their stories, and they can barely get through their stories. Extraordinary stories of a great pain and abandonment and abuse and violence and addiction. Very painful. They can barely get through them without sobbing. They're both thoroughly in their recovery now, but both had given birth to babies in their addiction, and had to watch as the babies were taken immediately from them and raised by strangers. Just unspeakable pain. So we fly home, and we get into the parking lot at Burbank Airport, and I said, you know, excuse me a second, I have to call my mom. She's 86 years old, and it's a ritual we have because she always wants to know, did I get home safely? And Tammy's in the front seat. And, you know, I call my mom, and I said, we got back from San Francisco. Well, remind me, what were you doing there? And I said, well, it was a conference, and I have these two wonderful women who went with me, and we spoke to 1,000 judges. Oh, well, that's nice. Well, thank you. I'm glad you got home safe. So I hang up the phone, and Tammy goes, huh. I go, what? Yeah. You called us wonderful women. And so she looked at me and got very still, and she said, I don't know. When you say it, I believe you. See something, say something, return folks to themselves. They'll believe you. Kinship so quickly. Then we see what God sees, and we understand the amplitude of our God, this all-accepting, limitless lover. We see the wideness in God's mercy, and we want to participate in that larger love. In this past fall, and I'll end with this, a lot of universities, some universities, you know, I took my book and forced their students to read it, you know, so, and I couldn't be more grateful. But one was one was my alma mater, Gonzaga University in Spokane. Any Zags in this room? There you go. So I went up there, and because they were going to pay for two homies to come with me, I brought Bobby, African-American gang member who works in the bakery, and Mario, who I hope you'll meet. He's at our booth. And I've taken hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of homeboys and homegirls with me on trips, and I always take homies and homegirls who have never been on a plane. I know you've heard this before. You read it in the book. And I always go out of my way to do that. And I never in my whole life have ever taken anybody more paniqueado and terrified than this guy, Mario. He was just hyperventilating, terrified. And I kept thinking to myself, oh, my God, you know, are we going to be able to do this without calling the paramedics, you know? So, and he's just so nervous. And we're at Burbank. And Burbank is, you know, kind of a small airport. And you can look out the window, and your seat's right by the window. And the plane arrives. And it was in the morning. And it's tarmac. There's no hermetically sealed tube you go into. You walk out onto the tarmac. And they have two stairs, the front of the plane and the back of the plane. And our plane arrives. I say, hey, there's our plane. And Mario's just so nervous. And people get off. And then I watch two flight attendants, females, with two large cups of Starbucks coffee, and they're clumping up the front stairs. And they're our flight crew for this plane that hasn't boarded yet. And Mario goes, when are they going to board the plane? And I point to the flight attendant. I say, well, as soon as they sober up the pilot. there they go now. All right, maybe I shouldn't have said that. I'll admit that I'm not very good at this. You know, I years ago, I took three homies with me to San Francisco. It was one kid, a little squirrely kid named Joey, who was just so terrified, never been on a plane. And he, you know, he kept saying to me, let me remind you, I'm not a frequent flyer, you know. He'd never been on a plane in his life. So we're about to land, and you know how pilots are at the very last minute, they get on. Flight attendants, prepare for arrival. And it's the pilot speaking, and so Joey gets kind of, oh my God, that was the pilot. What did he say? I didn't hear it. And I said, I didn't catch it all either. It's something about emergency landing. I heard parachutes. Parachutes was in there. Anyway, I'm not very good at that. So I should tell you that, and you'll see Mario, and Mario is one of the most tattooed individuals that has ever worked at Homeboy. He's just completely sleeved out in his whole face and neck and forehead. And so I'd never been in public with him, and so I watched people in the terminal at Burbank Airport, you know, and they're kind of recoiling, and mothers are vaguely clutching their kids more close. Which is odd because, as you will see when you, and I hope you'll go meet him and tell him I was talking about him, but that he's among the most gentle, kind, angelic gang members I've ever known. Though the packaging might suggest otherwise. There's a great poem by Rumi where and he writes the poem to God and he says, "You are in every kindness." And God is in this kid through his extraordinary kindness. So for as terrified as he was about flying, he still never lost the sense of kindness and tenderness, even on the plane where he was so terrified. You know, the flight attendant would hand him peanuts, and he wouldn't just thank her. He would grab her hand, look her in the eye, and he'd say, "Thank you so much." I mean, it was extraordinary. He was like that all the time. Well, there was the big talk at night in Spokane. But then during the day, they had scheduled, like they always, people always do this, you know, class, lunch, class, meeting, class, the whole day packed. And I tell the two of them, "Look, I'm not going to speak at any of these things, only at night. So you're going to do it, and I'll sit in the back of the classroom." Well, they were a little hesitant, but they ended up telling their stories, and they weren't used to it. And sometimes you don't know you have a story until you tell them. And then the nighttime comes, and it's the big talk. It's 45 minutes, and it's packed. 1,000 people, standing room only, students sitting on the floor. It's in direct violation of fire code. It's just packed. And so I told them, I said, "I'm going to speak for 45 minutes, and then you, Bobby and Mario, you're going to get up, and you're going to do a little five-minute snapshot so that we can include you in the question and answer period." And they were okay with it, but Mario was particularly kind of nervous, but they did a good job. So then we're done. Okay, so I say, "Yes, question and answer." And a woman over here stands, and she says, "Yeah, I have a question. It's for Mario." First question out the gate is for Mario, and he steps up to the microphone. "Yes." And he's just terrified. And the woman says, "Well, you say that you're a father and that you have a son and a daughter, and they're about to enter into their teenage years. What wisdom do you impart to them? What advice do you give them?" And Mario thinks for a long time, and he closes his eyes, and he wants to get this right, and then he suddenly blurts out, and he catches himself. And he chokes up and he can barely speak, but he wants to get this out. "I just don't want my kids to turn out to be like me." And there's silence until the woman stands who asked the question, and she said, "Why would you not want your kids to turn out to be like you? You are kind, you are gentle. You are wise, you are loving. I hope your kids turn out to be like you." And 1,000 strangers stand, and they will not stop clapping. And all Mario can do is hold his face in his hand, so overwhelmed that these total perfect strangers had decided to return him to himself. And I think that's the only praise God has any interest in. It's mutual. If we walk in the light, as John writes, then we have fellowship with each other, that you may be one. We bark to the choir so that together we can enter kinship. Now, hear this. To lose the earth you know for greater knowing, to lose the life you have for greater life, to leave the friends you loved for greater loving, to find a land more kind than home, more large than earth. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks, you're very kind. We're going to have 10 minutes for questions and hopefully answers. And there's a microphone up here. I don't know how we do this. Find your way to a, I'm gonna invite you up in a second, Frank. Anybody have any questions? Come up to the microphone. I know that's hard to do. Yeah.
Buenos dias.
Buenos dias.
Estoy muy emocionada con su plática. Quería saber cómo usted ve a estas personas detrás de lo que aparentan ser. Mm-hmm. Porque no tenemos el corazón para ver.
Yeah.
Vemos lo superficial.
Yeah.
So, ¿cómo nos puede decir cómo usted mira detrás de él?
Uh-huh. Voy a contestar esta pregunta en inglés y después vamos a platicar un poco. The question is about, you know, how do you get beyond the superficial part, you know, with homies? And, I don't know if it's so, you can't demonize people you know. And if you get to know anybody, no human being can sustain demonizing for very long. And so you get to see people, but mainly awe, you know, where you get to a place where kids have to carry so much. And so you stand with great respect. You know, I just sort of won the lottery in terms of growing up, you know, two wonderful parents and honest to God, you know, and five sisters and two brothers and opportunities and... And I can't for the life of me conjure up trauma. But I lucked out, that's all. And so where in the world would I get off thinking that I was morally superior to the kids growing up in my community because I didn't join a gang, you know? That's kind of nutsy. My life has never asked or required of me to carry things that the kids in my office have had to carry. Torture. Unspeakable things that parents and adults ought not to do to kids, and so I just stand in awe. So it's easier than we think. Go ahead, just go on and stand up there.
I believe you really are the Mother Teresa of Los Angeles, and
oh God.
A very. You are a true saint, and what I want to say is so that you come back and can to speak to such a large audience, we need to fill out the evaluation forms to get him back. And the other thing I want you to know is to get his t-shirts. I've been to Homeboy Cafe to really support him, and the salsa is great, and honestly, but filling out those evaluations will get him back in this room. So he's a great speaker, and we want you here next year.
Thank you. Yeah, it just to the saint thing, just ask my Jesuit brothers who have to live with me. That will dispel all rumors. Yes, sir.
To what extent have Homeboy Industries begun to extend itself beyond Los Angeles?
I always get asked that question, and we don't. We decided about 5 years ago not to do it because once we got to our large headquarters and found that we were serving the whole county, it was kind of like that's where we wanted to stay, because we didn't want to airlift this into another city and become the McDonald's of gang intervention programs, you know. Over 5 billion gang members served, you know. And so we thought, well, maybe it'll be a model, you know. And so what we do offer is what we call technical assistance. So there are probably 20 programs in the country that are sort of modeled after Homeboy. And so we're next year, in our 25th year, we're going to start what we call the Homeboy Network and gather and convene and maybe share, you know, best practices and that kind of thing. You know, so there's the City Cafe in Wichita started because they came to Homeboy and spent 5 days, and we've been there, and same in Spokane, and Brotherhood Brew in St. Paul. So all these things that are sort of born, you know, from Homeboy that have kind of this piece of economic development and such. And so it's been very gratifying. You know, last summer we had 11 different countries come and visit. And then we're constantly, every week we have a city somewhere in the country. We had Memphis last week. And they come and they hunker down and spend some time. And it's that's sort of what we want to do. Because in the end, anything worth doing is born from below rather than airlifted in from on high. And so we want to kind of support that idea.
You do a lot of motivational speaking, and I live in San Luis Obispo and do a lot of work up at the California Men's Colony. And I wanted to know, do you do motivational speaking inside the prison to the men and women?
Yeah. I don't see myself as a motivational speaker, you know, in that kind of category necessarily. I don't know. But, you know, I do. Whenever I get invited, you know, people chew me out for not saying no, but I just was at San Quentin prison, so I gave a talk there, and a remarkable group of folks, and so I go wherever I'm invited. I've been there, you know, in San Luis Obispo, and I've spoken at women's prisons, and, you know, or sometimes I'll be invited to preside, and, you know, so I'll do that there, you know. It's funny, I got denied entrance initially into San Quentin, and I've been to every prison in the state. And I even had what they call a brown card at one point.
Right.
And where I was chaplain at Folsom Prison, I thought, well, this is weird. I was denied access. Well, then I found out why is because I guess they keep track of who inmates write. And I was on so many lists of so many inmates, so many it's called the correspondence list. So
right.
They keep track of who they write. And like I'm on, you know, hundreds and hundreds of them, and so this obviously made me suspect, so I had to fax them a note.
Cornel West says, to lead the people, you must love the people, and to save them, you must serve them, and that is exactly what it is that I see you do, is lead by example and inspire so much hope in us all. And my question to you is, what strategies do you use when having the rival gang members work together, the African American and the Latinos working together? What strategies do you use to build that within our communities, and not only in LA County, but in the Inland Empire and other counties?
Yeah, thank you, good question and good quote. I'd never heard that quote. Yeah, I think it's not so much a strategy because, you know, our program is decidedly like a rehab. So it's not for those who need help, it's only for those who want it. So you have to walk through the doors. You know, if you don't walk through the doors, you're not going to get this help. We can all help homies get a life, but only they can come up with the desire to want to have one. And so we wait for them. And so it's never a thing where you try to, you know, push and pull people. And you just wait for them. You know, I think maybe I've mentioned this before, but I was on the Dr. Phil show last year, and it's always struck me because you know, we were trying to talk the producers down from doing something dumb, and we thought we had succeeded, you know, and then and the whole show was dedicated to Homeboy Industries, and so I'm off stage, and Dr. Phil says, and now, ladies and gentlemen, Father Greg Boyle, and I walk out there, and to my horror, on the stage, Phil is sitting in his stool, and my empty stool is next to him, awaiting me. On his side of the stage is a beautiful mahogany coffin on wheels and a gurney. On my side of the stage is a perfectly reconstructed jail cell with bed, toilet, sink. Well, you already know where this is going. They flew out to L.A., three kids, boys, 14, 15, 16, somewhere in there, with their single mother, distraught mothers. And these are kids who were all gravitating perilously close to gang activity. And, of course, you know exactly what Phil's going to do. With each kid, each successive kid, he sort of grabs them figuratively by the lapel and says, don't you see what this choice is doing, you know, and it's going to lead you to death or prison. Well, by the third kid, I finally told Phil, how do I break this to you? These kids know this better than we do. You know, they know that this will lead to death or to prison, but they don't care whether it'll lead to death or to prison. So the task is not to supply them with sufficient information, but the task is to infuse them with hope, because hope is foreign. And because nobody has met a hopeful kid who joined a gang. That's never happened in the history of kids. It's never happened in the history of gangs. So we have this mentality that somehow we're going to convince people to do something or give them enough information where they're going to, you know, slap their forehead and say, I could have had a V8, you know. A parenthesis, I'm in 25 different detention facilities where I say mass and in all the probation camps. And so I'm in a camp in a gym, and there are about 100 gang members there. And after mass, homies came up and surrounded me as I'm kind of cleaning up the table. And a kid says to me, I saw you on Oprah. I said, well, no, actually it was Dr. Phil. Oh, I said, yeah, I have a hard time telling those two apart myself. And then this kid over here said, you were on Dr. Phil? Fighting with your wife. And I said, yes, but you know, he gave us really good advice and we're doing way better. Thank you. I thank you for asking. How about one last question, because I need to do a public service announcement.
Thank you so much for allowing us to ask you questions. And my question is, how can we get more involved? People, you know, get our kids involved, to help out, because I was very compelled to, you know, your Homeboy Industries and what you do, and I know you've been all over, and what can we do to help?
Well, you know, all hands on deck. You know, you don't have to help at Homeboy Industries, in your own community. The first step is always to make sure that we don't disqualify ourselves. If you are the owner of a pulse, and I'm going to presume most of you are, that you can be, in fact, a beneficial presence to kids who are just longing for some attention, some divided or undivided attention. And then you can help. So you roll up your sleeves instead of sticking your head in the sand and get your parishes to reach out, to visit the detention facilities, to expand our own vision about things that are happening. Like I'm going to get some Francisco up here to talk about the death penalty. Or right now, I want to invite people to the Responsibility, Rehabilitation, and Restoration conference that will happen on August 3 and 4, and some nice folks will be handing this out. And the fact that the Supreme Court at the moment is trying to change the fact that we remain the only country on the planet Earth that sentences children to die in prison. Parishes need to be talking about that. That's of grave moral concern. That's what would bother Jesus probably more than some other issues that we kind of focus on. And speaking of which, I want to invite up here one last, don't leave, hang on for one second. I want to invite my own personal hero, Francisco Herrera.
So we have a closing ritual for everybody here. Buenos dias, buenas tardes. And And that is that Bishop Garcia from Monterrey Diocese is here with us, supporting the Safe California campaign to end the death sentence. But it's there's 800,000 people have signed already the petition to get on the ballot to replace 800,000, mostly Catholics. So get your pens out, get ready to replace a death penalty with life without chance for parole. And we will now be having a prayer vigil, and also joined with Bishop Garcia will be Sister Helen Prejean. So we're going to ask folks to get up and walk over here to the east side of the east side, orale, east side of the stage, and we're going to do a procession. We're going to go out here singing a very famous song everybody knows, and we're going to around the fountain, and then the grassy knoll, another code word. The grassy knoll. We're going to go to the grassy knoll, and there we're going to do a prayer vigil. We're going to be praying with Bishop Garcia, and a few words also from Sister Helen. And there's a small play, actually, skit that will be presented there. So if people want to join us in prayer and vigil for replacing the death penalty with life and be moving forward, please. This is a very famous song everybody knows already. Let's try singing it together. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. One more time, together. This little light. I'm together now. This little light of mine.